purport. Upon being asked by Vidura, the sage Maitreya began to explain the cause of misunderstanding between Lord Shiva and Daksha, because of which goddess Sati gave up her body. Thus begins the history of a great sacrifice performed by the leaders of the universal creation, namely Marichi, Daksha and Vasishtha. These great personalities arranged for a great sacrifice for which demigods like Indra and fire gods assembled with their followers. Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva were also present. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. So we have seen how the first, this is the fourth verse, first two verses we're giving basically the outline of this chapter, where it was explained that how Shiva, who is such a great personality, peaceful personality, how is it possible that Daksha became inimical to him and cursed him? In this connection, the first two verses we had discussed many things with respect to how certain things lead to offenses, because both were great personalities. Daksha was also great, and Lord Shiva was also a great personality. Now is it that these two personalities enter into this kind of a uncomfortable situation where Daksha cursed Lord Shiva? And we discussed how the absolute truth is not impersonal. The absolute truth or the eternal truth is that Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam. There is one supreme being and there are many, many living beings. This is the absolute truth. That being so, the question of how living being to living being relationship how it should be, what it should not be, these all constitute offense. If somebody is not giving due respect to another living entity, then that constitutes an offense. Just like we say offense to the holy name, if we don't give due respect to the holy name, then it's an offense to the holy name. An offense to the holy name, the offenses. Vaishnavas do not take offenses. As we saw in the example of Ambarish and Durvasa Muni. The factual offender was Durvasa Muni. Durvasa Muni just he got hurt because he had expectation. Durvasa Muni had expectation of what kind of respect that Ambarish should give to him. Because of that expectation, it became a very personal thing, attachment, and he got hurt. When there is expectation, you get hurt. The subject of respect is something which is to be finely understood by the Vaishnavas. giving respect and taking respect. If Durvasa Muni did not feel hurt, he would actually, even if there was an offense, he would forgive first. Similarly, in this case also, if you see Daksha, if he was very elevated, he was not sufficiently elevated, even if he felt offended, to forgive. So there was no forgiveness. Rather than not forgiving, he cursed. So the Vaishnava's character is that even if there is any violation of etiquette, because the etiquette is not for his satisfaction, for his pleasure. If it is not for his pleasure, then one would not get upset. If one does not get upset, one does not curse. Curse means becoming personal. Vaishnavas never curse. Even if somebody is obviously offending the Vaishnavas, pray for that other Vaishnava. Some circumstantially it has happened. That way the devotee is praying to the Lord. So this is the spirit that the Vaishnava has to cultivate with regard to even real offense. What to speak of simply perceived offense? Because of our false ego, we perceive it as offense. Just like Durvasa Muni, out of false ego, he perceived it as offense. He didn't try to find out what is the situation, why Ambarish behaved in a particular way, etc. He didn't bother to find out. So all these wonderful examples are given in Srimad Bhagavatam, because Bhagavatam is a literature of pure bhakti. In pure bhakti, the devotee himself does not expect any respect. And that is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has taught. Amanina manadena kirtaniya sadahari. In fact, Bhakti Vinod Thakur says, when will the day come when I can offer respect to every living entity, and that day the Shuddha Nama will dance on my tongue. Unless we give up taking respect in our heart, there is something in our heart and there is something physical, external etiquettes. The worldly etiquette is there. We have to allow others to give that respect that is due as per the worldly standard, not as we calculate what is due. Let's take a sannyasi. A sannyasi is, socially there is a respect due to a sannyasi, socially. So socially people pay that extra respect to that ashrama, sannyasa ashrama. But the sannyasi in his heart, he should not consume that respect. The Chaitanya's philosophy. You don't consume that. Just because he does not want to consume, because it's good for his bhakti, doesn't want to consume that respect, the sannyasi cannot tell the other ashrama, you don't give that respect, because sannyasi has a duty to receive respect but not consume it. So he cannot stop others from giving respect. Oh, this world of respect is all very complicated. I'll run away to the forest. One may say, this best is to run away to the forest. Be away from all society. Actually speaking, yes, in our heart, when we are in this world, if we want real bhakti, we should make our devotion service socially independent. It should not depend upon social approval. Of course, everybody, our scriptures say, is to please the Vaishnavas. Vaishnavas are pleased when a devotee does not seek social approval. It's a stage of development, spiritual development of a soul, that at some time before he gets pure bhakti or before he starts the journey of pure devotion service, he has to become independent of social approval. Otherwise, we become trapped in this motivation for devotional service will be social approval. To become independent, socially independent, is a very big freedom for a Vaishnava. Otherwise, the Vaishnava is always stuck. What is he thinking? The outside world is like that. Outside world, everybody, because that is their society. Not only sense gratification, social gratification, constantly comparing and constantly seeking approval. What do they think, etc., etc.? What do the neighbors think? Then how is that replaced? How does a Vaishnava replace that tendency in the mind? Because ultimately we are a social being. So we should be able to, based on principles, just like Prabhupada said, Prabhupada, how do we know we are pleasing you? He said, you follow my instruction, then you are pleasing me. So you have to know what constitute pleasure of Guru and Krishna. And one of the things that constitute Guru and Krishna is to engage in devotional service without seeking any social approval. Social approval means a kind of respect. One engages in devotional service based on devotional principles. So if he becomes aware of the devotional principles, then he is not affected by what others think. And if we go by what others think, then our consciousness will be kicked up and down like a football. So it is a great... It's a very big liberation during our spiritual journey to become independent of social approval, independent of social gratification. Otherwise, it's a miserable life. If you have to satisfy 100 people, then it becomes miserable life. At the same time, one should feel confirmation, satisfaction that I am on the proper track. For that, one has to go by the principles of devotional life. And very often, in a situation of dilemma where a lot of emotions are involved, and that is where we have to simply act based on the principles and not allow the mind. Mind is an emotional body. When we use our intelligence and devotional principles to control our emotions and then be on the track of proper devotional service, progressive devotional service. Otherwise, it is a weed. We should be ambitious for Prabhupada. Doesn't mean that ambition is to show to the world. That means you should desire the desires of Srila Prabhupada, how I can contribute my little service to Srila Prabhupada's vision. That is ambitious, ambition. These ambitions are not contaminated or are mixed by, if mixed by what the society of devotees think, what the devotees, they all should ultimately know. They should know that I have contributed towards Prabhupada's ambition. But the problem is, ultimately we are here for bhakti. We are here to purify our heart. This is not our place. Material world is not our place. It's not our home. I don't seek anything in this world. I seek the pleasure of Guru and Krishna. I seek the pleasure of Guru, the way Guru has told, what he said, how he said. The Guru has told, work in an institution, work in an institution. Please the immediate authorities in the service matters. Make that as a this. At the same time, one should constantly feel that one is directly pleasing Prabhupada and Krishna, and that kind of a thing will, that kind of a taste to feel in the heart Prabhupada's pleasure will take away this desire for pleasure from the society. So they're very, very, unless all these principles are adhered to, just like Daksha should not have cursed. Curse means anger. Anger means personal gratification. And he cursed. When there is no expectation at all from the society, then the devotee is so peaceful. He doesn't expect respect. So he won't even recognize somebody is giving respect or not giving respect. Those who are expecting respect are constantly looking. Who is going to give me respect? Who is not giving me respect? He is respecting. He is not respecting. So it becomes a disease. It becomes an obsession. Attachment to any emotion is called obsession. Obsession is a material disease. Anything, you get obsessive disorder. Any kind of obsession is considered as material disease. Obsession with any idea, obsession with any sense object, obsession. That means, you know, you are constantly pulled by that beyond your control. That's called obsession. Your mind, it very deeply ingrained in the mind, the conditioning is so deep. And how does obsession come? Obsession comes by contemplation. We contemplate on the object that creates the obsession. Go on contemplating, contemplating, contemplating. Contemplating means what? Oh, how sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is. How enjoyable it is, how enjoyable it is. With that
with that and then it will reinforce that same thing by past incidents. Oh, how nice it was, how tasty it was. Then that memory. So contemplation means going on thinking again and again, recalling that and thinking how good it was, how good it was, how good it was. That is called contemplation. Each time you say that, it gets so deeply emotionally ingrained into our system that as soon as we see the sense object, immediately obsession is there. Intellect is not there. Intellect stops working. Intellect stops working. So obsession can be of anything. These are all yantra. This yantra goes wrong. Depends on how you feed your yantra. You feed wrong things into the yantra, then it just gives you, creates that obsession. And then any obsession decreases the efficiency of a person, overall efficiency of a person, including people lose health, everything, because their entire emotion requires prana. Their entire prana is consumed there. Continuously it goes there, trying to solve the problem of that. So one has to become detached. At least one has to understand first that in this material life, we should not be obsessed with anything. Anything we are obsessed means even materially, for a yantra wise, it is abnormal. Deep attachment, whether to husband, to wife, to children, to anything. Our obsession should be only with Krishna. Our obsession should be with Prabhupada's books, Prabhupada, chanting holy name. That's where our obsession should be. How to offenselessly chant. These are all things that we should be obsessed with. So unless we prepare ourselves by hearing all these wonderful leelas, especially there are a lot of things to learn from this chapter, Daksha curses Lord Shiva. Between the Vaishnavas, what happens? In a Vaishnava's community, what happens? See, look at this. This is completely exact example of, in a former time, the leaders of the universal creation performed a great sacrifice in which all the great sages, philosophers, demigods, fire gods assembled with their followers. The big universal assembly. And there this thing happened, respect and disrespect. And there is so much to learn from this, so instructive. So many instructive things we will be hearing from Maitreya. Any questions?
Hare Krishna Prabhu. In this chapter, Lord Shiva is actually Dhira. He is not disturbed by... Because when Daksha cursed and scolded, means used bad names, Lord Shiva was not at all disturbed. But when he heard that Sati passed away, he got so much disturbed and he showed so much anger. Is it because of a deep attachment for his wife?
It is because, you see, you don't get angry when somebody hurts you. The Vaishnava principle is that you get angry when another Vaishnava is hurt. So when he heard that Sati is harmed, naturally, he cannot show his peacefulness at that time. Just like Hanuman did not show his peacefulness. He's a great devotee. Prabhupada always gives the example of dovetailing anger like Hanuman. So everything has its place. There's nothing like absolutely no angry and all those things. That is the highest state of being a Vaishnava. There are principles. If a Vaishnava is offended, you will get angry. You should get angry. You should defend.
So Lord Shiva took it as a offense towards a Vaishnava.
To Sati. Because it was disrespect that resulted in her giving her life, that she is hurt, isn't it? She is hurt so much,
And the consequence was she gave up her life. So therefore he lost his he became angry.
It is not because of that husband-wife relationship, means
not Shiva is where he lives in Smashana. What is his attachment? No graha, nothing. He is giving an opportunity to a soul like Sati to serve him. That is why she is wife. An opportunity to serve a great Vaishnava. You should take it like that.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Can we be obsessed with the results of our service?
No. Obsession means disease. That is why Krishna says karmaneva adhikaraste. How can you be obsessed? You cannot be obsessed.
Or attachment?
Huh?
Or attachment or desire?
For no, nothing.
Results of our service?
No obsession. Obsession means personal ego comes. There is somewhere there is my gratification, etc. Otherwise it's not obsession. By the will of the Lord wills, yes, I will do my duty. I will try my best. You should not get obsessed. Obsessed, then you will make offenses. If somebody disturbs your service, you won't even analyze whether he is rightly done or wrongly done, or even let's say the authority takes away that service from you. When obsession is there, then you will say, what's wrong with these people? This is a service to Prabhupada. I want to serve Prabhupada. They are disturbing me. And you start making offense. Obsession stops intelligence from thinking. You know, you stop using intelligence when you get obsessed with anything. In the Bhagavad Gita also, Krishna says everything should be in moderation. Isn't it? Obsessed about sleeping too much. You should sleep what is required. That's not obsession. Eat. Obsession with eating. We can be obsessed about somewhere we had put our obsession. Directly obsessed with Krishna chanting Hare Krishna, be obsessed about following Prabhupada's principles, be obsessed about trying to become pure. So all there, that is the right way to be obsessed.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. But sometimes while a devotee is living in a devotee community.
Obsessed means possessed. A ghost possesses, no? So a desire obsesses you. Then you have no control over yourself. You know sobriety. Everywhere that is, that obsession will, just like if somebody is obsessive with opposite sex, everywhere he will see only that. His filter will show his object of obsession. There are hundreds of things before his eyes. But when there is obsession, then only that it will filter, and your consciousness is all, your attention is always on that. You see what you are obsessed with. A businessman obsessed with money making, he doesn't see people, nothing. He sees situation where there is a profit here. Obsession. Yes.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Prabhu, when a devotee is living in a devotee community, on a vyavaharic level, there may be different perceptions which are formed. Now, it may be partially true, the perceptions, like somebody may label him that this person is like this or... So, how should a devotee respond to this kind of a situation?
Respond to whom?
Like, should he present himself that this perception is partially true? It is not 100% true.
Present where?
To authorities.
about somebody.
About
A,
himself.
About B, about himself.
About himself.
Yeah, you want association, if you think something wrong, you can, you know, authorities can be your mirror. Is this correct? You can ask. So then in association, you open up and you can ask. And then you will get benefited. Because sometimes you cannot see this obsession. Yourself, you cannot see this obsession because you are lost in it. When you are lost in it, you cannot see. So many people keep telling, but the person will not see. When somebody is completely lost in something, he is inside there. Those who are outside, they are seeing. So unless the person comes out and sees, oh, this is what he is saying, this is what they are saying, now I understand. Helplessly, he say, no, it's not, I don't think anything wrong with me. But at some, if you take the point of view, you come out of that and have submissive hearing, and there is acceptance. Oh, Prabhu, you are saying this, I accept. You should first accept, then you will come out and you will see, yes, it is true. See, if you don't accept, then we cannot cure, no? No action will be taken to cure. So first we have to accept. So first step towards any self-correction, self-reformation, is to accept the shortcomings. And then you will feel what is missing. If you go on saying, no, I don't have anything shortage. I'm not finding any shortage. Then you will not take from outside. You will not receive. Everything will be bounced. Once acceptance is there, then it's a question of time. Very fast. Once there is acceptance, immediately transformation happens. And that is why that acceptance is connected to repentance also. Suppose there is a, you know, something shortcoming. Then the consequences of that shortcoming, one should contemplate and repent. When one repents, then there is a strong acceptance of that shortcoming. It results in quick transformation. So Shastras also say repentance. In Vaishnava philosophy also, repentance. See all the great acharyas. They are repenting, I have wasted my life. Right? They already come into the positive, they are chanting very purely and everything. But that repentance is not gone out of the heart. That I wasted my life. He could easily have passed his pasture. Chalo. Now I got the holy name, everything, now boom, chalo. No. They feel responsible that it is the same me who acted there. And the same Krishna, I forgotten Krishna's service, and I was engaged in activities of Maya, like that the devotee is thinking, then that person is completely insulated from Maya, if there is repentance. There is no repentance, repetition, it will repeat again and again. When a devotee falls down, there has to be repentance. When there is repentance, he will not fall again. Any other question? Gandharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.